Namespace. Okay, my name is Waiman. I'm a kernel, Linux kernel engineer working on both the upstream kernel as well as the Red Hat Enterprise Linux kernel. And this talk is about a feature in the Linux kernel called control group. Right now, there are currently yeah, I'm showing up here, but it didn't.
Are you mirroring?
No. Maybe I should be.
Let's just see what happens if you put yours up there then.
Okay.
I will admit that I presented up before and not for because of.
Okay.
Are you on Google? Are you on Google Slides? Okay.
No, just
What do you mean?
Okay. Okay. So what is the control group? A control group in mechanism where you try to work a set of related processes into one under one control umbrella so that you can control the resource that are allocated to that set of processes that are running in the system. So you can partition all the processes in the system into multiple groups and then assign different resources to each of those groups. And that is what a control group is for. Together with namespace, which is a mechanism that allows you to show only selected set of resources to the user process, they form the basis of what we do for container as well as for virtual machine. So there are many kernel resources that can be controlled by control group, like the amount of CPU you have, the amount of memory, what I/O devices that you can use for a specific container or virtual machine, as well as the network, the process, the number of process ID you can use in the system. So how to use control group? From the kernel perspective, control group is controlled by exporting a set of virtual file system where you write the desired value into the virtual file system. To move process into it and to set the all the resource limit that you want for that control group. the control group. So each process running a system associated one of the directory in the control group. By default, when you start up a process, it's most likely in the root directory, the root control group, and then you can use the make directory command to create additional control group that you can move process into it, as well as setting different set of resources for those processes that belong to that new control group. And so these are just some examples of the virtual file that you are available for the CPU set control group. And each of the CPU set is what we call a controller. So there are many set of controller for controlling different resources in the system. And how to use control group? Basically, you can directly access the control, the virtual control file for each of the control group to assign process as well as set up all the resources. But in reality, user usually use some abstraction layer, like use the cgroup and cgexecute, those kind of command. Or in reality, most middleware layer, they provide some interface that you can control what system can be classified group into different control group. So user seldom directly write into the control group, the control file for the C group. And right now there are two versions of control group that are supported in by the Linux kernel, the V1 and the version 1 and version 2. Version 1 is in the kernel terminology, what we call the legacy hierarchy, and version 2, we call it the default hierarchy, because this is what we, the kernel engineer want to promote, to move from V1 to V2. And basically V1 are in mostly maintenance mode. There may be a little bit of new feature here and there, but most of the development activity focus on C group V2. And so you want to use some new feature that they are provided by the control group system, you will need to move to V2 eventually, because many of those new features may not be available in V1. And in terms of internal, within the control group subsystem, there's a core set of functionality that are shared by or used by all the different controller, and then there are some controller-specific functionality that's specific to one of the controller. And right now, the currently available controller, including a controller to control the block I/O, the CPU, and CPU set is just deciding which CPU or which memory node you can use for a process. And then there's a device, feature, huge TLB, so there's a list there. I'm not going to go into each of them one by one, but if you have questions, you can ask about it. now we're talking about the hierarchy. So control group are managed like a directory tree. So you have a word control group, and then underneath the word control group, you can create sub-control group underneath it. So and it's like a tree structure, so you can have multiple level of nesting within the control group hierarchy. And for the version one control group, each controller can have its own hierarchy. So as a result, you look at the control group directory within any Linux system, you can see multiple subdirectory, one for each of the controller. But then the flexibility of combining different VN controller, and you can put process. A process can be in one control, one SQL hierarchy maybe a level one, but then in another SQL hierarchy, it can be deep in level two or even level three below. So that creates a lot of complexity that the kernel need to manage in order to make sure that you know exactly on which control group each of the process is in. And there are cases where one controller may want to coordinate with another one to provide some kind of joint feature that require both. But it's very hard to do in SQL V1 because a process can be played anywhere in two completely different hierarchy or different tree. So they very hard to coordinate between two different controllers. And this is where the SQL V2 come in. The idea behind SQL V2 is that we provide only one unified hierarchy for all the controller. So you only put the process one point in the hierarchy, in the tree, in the SQL hierarchy tree, and then you know that all the controller, you can make sure that different controller in the same position in the tree will be able to work together, because they will be sure that they all share the same set of process. And one of the new controller that are available is called the write-back controller. It controls the amount of write-back depending on the amount of the memory bandwidth you use. So you need cooperation between the block I/O and the memory controller, and the only way you can do this is through the SQL V2 system. Because in V1, you just can't coordinate between different two completely different trees. And how to use the unified hierarchy? Not all the cgroup V1 controller are currently available in unified hierarchy. Some of them may never be supported in V2, and some of them may remain remain as V1 only, unless there is a strong request to do it up. Some of those controllers may not move at all. A given controller can be either in V1 control group or V2, so you can't have the same controller in both. So you have to make a decision when you start a system whether you want to use that controller in a V2 control group or in a V1 control group. You can't do it both. So by default, when the system boot up, the system tools like systemd will bind each of controller to its own hierarchy, and so whatever lab that isn't mounted on but into the V1 cgroup, then it will be available as V2 when you mount the V2 cgroup. So, but you can also use a boot command parameter cgroup_node V1 to specify the controller that shouldn't be available in V1 and it should be in V2 only. So this is one way for you to offer a kind of change the way that the system allocate which controllers should go to V1 and V2.
Is this basically a deprecation mechanism? So like right now it's cgroup no V1, but then by future kernels it's going to be by default there's no V1, and then you'll have to explicitly enable it if you need it, and then it'll be gone. Is that the idea?
Well, the idea is we want to eventually deprecate the V1, but right now V1 is still very heavily used, so that's why by default if the system mount a V1 controller, then it will be in V1 only, and whatever left is available in V2. But you can override that by using this option.
Is it not even considered deprecated yet?
Not yet. Yeah. But we are moving in that direction, okay. but it's not, yeah.
But we should treat it as deprecated.
Yeah, basically. cgroup V2 also supports a concept of delegation, so where less privileged user is allowed to manage a subtree within the overall hierarchy. And so that feature will allow the use of a container that don't need a privilege to manage the control group within its own hierarchy. It's not available, and V1 doesn't have this feature. That's why one reason people are trying to move to V2 is because of all these new features that are available.
So I just gave a talk on delegation, so this really, because I think, can you give an example of like something that a privileged user or a less privileged user can do with a cgroup that you could do before?
Maybe you have bubble the user namespace.
Yeah.
And that is mostly used with the user namespace. So within the user namespace, the root within that particular namespace does not need to be actually have the root privilege in the whole system. So and you can use the delegation to allow it to manage all the SQL control file underneath its own tree. So, work like it would. So, because many of the control file can only be written by root or process with privilege. And so, in order for a non-root user to do it, you have to use the delegation mechanism. Okay. Unlike the legacy hierarchy, a controller in the unified hierarchy isn't enabled by default. So you have to explicitly enable each of the controller because that you can have multiple controller bind to the cgroup V2 subsystem, and you don't want to be explicitly enable all of them by default. So by default, they aren't enabled. And in order to enable a particular controller, you have to explicitly enable it using the cgroup substitute control file. Substitute control means that all the child ports, child directory underneath it will have that cgroup enabled. So the controller are by default all enabled at the root cgroup, but not on any of the child cgroup unless you enable it in the substitute control file. So as a result, even you have a hierarchy of different cgroup directory, not all the controller are enabled in all of them. So you can manage which controller are enabled in which one. Like you can enable CPU controller on the first level and not in, let's see, you can enable here. And so in this case, both A, B, C. So, for what I'm saying is when you enable CPU controller here in the subdirectory, then both these two A port, the CPU A and D, will have CPU set, will have CPU controller enabled, but not B and C by default. So, process within the B and C will use the controller in the parent, in the nearest parent that have that controller enabled. So we can think of it, this controller now control all the process within the A, B, and C directory. And flat mode. in SQL V1, we manage process by their flat ID. So each flat can, different flat of the same process can be in different hierarchy in the same controller tree. So that creates some complication in how you manage the resource, because for some of the resources like memory of all the threads within the same process, they share the memory space. So you just can't, so it doesn't make sense to manage each of the threads differently in terms of how you manage the memory. So so there are some controller that that can only be that are meaningful to be used for thread, where different thread can have different resources or limit applied to it. But there are other controller in memory that doesn't make sense to have different thread in different memory SQL. So SQL V2 have a feature called the threaded mode, where you have explicit enabled, because SQL V2 by default managed on the process level. So you write the process ID, and then all the threads within that process will go to that the SQL directory. But there are controllers like the CPU controller, which require thread level control. So different threads within the same process may have different CPU priority or different CPU resources that should be applied to it. So in order to allow a threaded controller to be used in a mainly process-based environment, we create a thread mode. One, you have to explicitly enable the thread mode in order to allow you to move different threads into different different directory within the tree structure. So this is how you use the thread mode. So you have to designate one of, you can't enable thread mode in the wood, but in the level one or below, you can enable the thread mode. And then once you enable it, this node is called the thread domain. And then underneath the thread domain, you can explicitly enable a cgroup that are threaded. Threaded means that it will only allow use to use controller that supported thread mode, like the CPU controller and some of the other one. But there are controller like memory that are not allowed to be used in thread mode. So memory controller will stay here, and to manage all this, you can't activate memory controller here when the thread mode, when the directory is designated as threaded. So only threaded controller can be activated in this level. And then underneath it, domain just means that you can't use threaded or you can't enable threaded controller here. You can keep on. And underneath a threaded directory, you have to all your subdirectory has to be threaded as well in order to for it to function well. But then underneath the domain, you can activate thread mode here and then create some additional thread subdirectory underneath it. Okay, let me see. So there are some behavior different between V1 and V2. First of all, the naming of the control file may differ a bit between V1 and V2. The reason of this is that V1 controller were developed independently by different developer over a period of time. So the naming convention and also the semantic of each of the control file may differ among between different controller, so you really have to know what those control file is and how to use them. There's not a consistent naming convention as well as semantic for all those control file. In V2, the kernel developer want to have a more consistent interface that look or feel similar for each of the different controller. So they apply more strict control of what you can name for each controller, and also because of the over time a lot of feature that are added to V1 controller may not have that many user or may not be that useful. So all those what we think as not that useful feature get dropped out of the V2, and so V2 provide more simplified interface. They are more consistent and supposedly easier to use than V1. So now we have to talk about how to migrate from cgroup V1 to V2. It's not an easy process. Because of the control file, the naming of the control file is different, as well as also the functionality may differ a bit between V1 and V2. So you have to kind of rewrite your application if you want to use V2. And upstream is currently doing that. They're trying to support SQL V2. So they provide like Libre or the system library, they will probably provide one version for V1 and another version for V2. So application can now choose to decide which one they want to use. They can use a V1 library to use SQL V1, or they can link with a V2 library and use SQL V2 for the application. And there are some, as I said before, there are some controller that are not core to the cgroup. They are now not being supported in V2. Instead, they advise people that they can use other mechanism to control those to provide similar feature like the EPPF program, or alternatively, they can still use them as a V1 controller.
Yes. Practically speaking, is that going to keep people from being able to move forward because the tooling and all that kind of stuff is assuming the C groups are there, and so you can say everything I want to do I can do in V2 except I need the CLS. C-groups.
Well, you can, those controllers you can still continue using it at V1. Yeah.
It's not just a case of you can't just switch the V2 stuff on and have everything work, right? It's going to require changes in tooling.
Well, a lot of these are very special use cases.
Okay.
They are not. In fact, most of the middleware library they don't use this cgroup at all.
Okay. What about the huge?
Here's TLB.
A better way to do it?
That isn't used by that many applications, actually. They're mostly used by enterprise application like Oracle database.
That's my world.
Yeah.
So what's going on with that?
Well, there is just no customer request to do it in V2, and that's why it stay there. And
that's going to lock us on to only having V1 then, right?
And in many cases, for you are running those entire applications, you probably want to have control the whole box instead of, because controller are used to partition the system into, and the application itself can manage it itself without using SQL at all. So it's probably a legacy that we provide, and I don't know how many people are actually using it, but I think it's not that many.
We will be, we'll find out.
Yep. If people complain. Yeah, this is usually how we move forward. If no one complains, we move on. If someone complains, then we will see how what we can do and to satisfy the demand. Okay, there are some issues with the unified hierarchy, SQL V2. So it does solve some of the problems that are associated with SQL V1, but then it also introduced some of its own and one of the drawbacks is that you can't have that freedom of using different controller in completely different hierarchy. You only have one hierarchy, and so you have to prepare how you want to structure the hierarchy and move stuff there. So it requires more thinking and planning for the user. And of all the SQL controller, the CPU controller has some performance implication with nesting. And the more level you nest, the more performance impact you may see. The reason is because of the way the scheduling work. They create, if you use CPU controller, they actually create some dummy one queue. Each of the controller have their own set of one queue. So the way the server is, you at the boot level, you choose the what they call a scheduled entity that you want to run. But the entity may not be actual process. It can be a subtree of processes. So once you select the entity, you have to go down to select which until you find a process that you can run. So it takes time, and that's why there's some performance implication to deep a level hierarchy that you want to do. There are developers working upstream trying to reduce the performance degradation associated with the CPU controller, but it's still work in progress, and we don't know how much that will improve. So, there is a proposed patch upstream. Actually, I proposed a patch, what I call the bypass mode, to try to work around that problem with the CPU controller. But the upstream developers still want to do it the other way, basically improving the performance degradation associated with CPU controller instead of adding a new mode to work around the problem. And now we talk about the SQL V2 core. So those are the control files that are associated with the V2 core. So they're all prefixed with the name SQL. There's a SQL controller, which is the only file that shows you what controller are available for that particular directory. And then there's a event file. I'm not going to go over all of them. The site will be posted on the DevCon website, so you can read it when you have time. So now I'll talk about each of the controller, like the CPU V2 controller. The CPU So this controller manage how much CPU time to be allocated to each to process within that particular control group. So they do it by using a weight, and also there's a max file to control the bandwidth. So they allowed it to the process within the control group. And so this is basically how the CPU controller, you have two processes with different weight, then the one with the higher weight will get allocate more CPU time than the one with a lower weight. And you can also control it by allocating the bandwidth, so the how much total time out of. So there's with bandwidth, there's a period like such as I think maybe 1 millisecond or so, and they allow you to run. You allocate a bandwidth of let's say 50%, then out of each 1 millisecond, you are only allowed to run 0.5 millisecond, and then the rest has to be used by process in the other control group. And then there's a CPU set controller. CPU set controller is used to control how much, you control which CPU and which memory node process within that SQL is allowed to use. So CPU controller is actually very useful, used by all the container management tools as well as the VM to control which CPU and memory node are allocated to each of the container or virtual machine. Because you don't want to, so you can partition a system into different partition of CPU and memory node and assign to different SQL. And SQL V2 also has a new feature called partition that allow you to actually partition the CPU resources and scheduling within that group of CPU only. So it will affect the way that the CPU schedule work. And then we have the SQL V2 memory controller. The controller manage how much memory how much physical memory allowed to be used by process within SQL. I want to distinguish between physical memory and virtual memory. So a process within a SQL can have a very big virtual memory space, but out of that big virtual memory space, only a tiny portion of it are actually allocated in the physical memory and used there. And memory controller is used to control how much physical memory that are actually being used, not the virtual memory. So, the way that memory controller work is that you can specify the high memory limit, so the amount of physical memory that are allowed to use by process within the controller. Once you reach that limit, then the system memory became capability will kick on to try to reclaim memory back from those processes. and then there's another control file called the memory max that specifies the maximum value, the maximum amount of physical memory you can actually reach before something bad happens. And what I mean by that is that an OM, our memory killer, will be activated and try to kill some random process. And so to kill some of the process so that it can actually reclaim those memory back. But invoking OM killer is never a good thing because there's little control of which process will actually get killed. So you want to avoid that as much as possible. And there are also some control file relating to how much swap space you can use and things like that. And then there's a I/O controller. One thing you can notice is that the naming convention between different controllers are more consistent than in V1. So you have both a max, a weight, stat. So those control files are there in many of the V2 control group. So once you see the name, you have a rough idea of what they are and how you can use them, even though they are controlling different resources within the system. Okay. The final one I want to talk about is cgroup namespace. Cgroup namespace provides a mechanism to virtualize what a process can view the cgroup hierarchy. So you are in a container, you don't want it to see other cgroup tree above its level. So you can use a cgroup namespace to do that. And cgroup namespace is also used for the delegation mechanism. So you can delegate the maintenance of that particular namespace to a non-root process. Okay, about the support of V2 in RHEL, we are not going to support cgroup V2 in RHEL 7, which is now entering maintenance mode. And because the inclusion report put in some kernel KPI, which we don't want to happen. And in RHEL XO, some of the V2 control group are not enabled because they are not merged upstream in time for that. So V2 in RHEL 8.0 will only provide SQL V2 as a technical preview mode. But then both the CPU set and freezer V2 controllers should be available in 8.1. And we are hoping to official support it in 8.2 timeframe, if possible. But it also depends on how the other middleware layer are able to support it or not. So from the kernel perspective, it's almost done. All the needed controllers are there. But we also need support in the middleware and on the higher level before we can claim official support. So looking forward, most people are still using cgroup V1 today. There are some companies are using V2 like Facebook. But then the trend is we are trying to move people away from V1 to V2. And it will take a while, maybe a few years to 10, maybe more. I don't know, depending on how much people are willing to move. So for what I'm thinking is that for a considerable period of time, both V1 and V2 will be supported. And until we are sure that most of the users are migrated to V2, we will keep supporting V1. But most likely in maintenance mode, so if there are any bug, we will try to fix it. But we are probably not going to add new feature into cgroup V1. Okay, and that's the end of my presentation. Do you have any question? Yeah.
You talked about deep CPU cgroup trees having a performance impact.
It happened in both V1 and V2.
Okay.
In performance impact, it's the same.
Yeah, I guess I was wondering, if you do that, is that just impacting the subtree, or is that impacting the entire operating system performance?
Well, you lose some performance if you have too deep a level of nesting. is mostly for process under those SQL tree. So if you have a process running at the wood level, the schedule is just managed like any other, and you allocate, let's say 50% of the CPU time, you will get 50%. But then there's some overhead for the scheduling. The scheduler itself has overhead, and the more level of nesting you have in the CPU controller, the more overhead it will consume. So overall speaking, the overall system performance will be less than what you would expect.
Last question.
So you're saying you want to wait for people to migrate to V2. Given the fact that V1 is such a train wreck, isn't it just a disaster waiting and not pushing people? I mean, I would argue that it's an absolute catastrophe that Rails 8 doesn't ship with V2 enabled.
Well, we are trying to push people forward. Like right now, for Rails 8, the default is SQL V1. In some future day, we will change the default to V2. But you can explicitly change the default back to V1 if the user wants. That's our way to move user forward by changing the default. Yeah, we agree. Well, one of the reasons why we have SQL V2 is because we don't want to break kernel KPI. We don't want to break existing application that are using V1. So we can't change it in a way that satisfies our need to provide new feature while at the same time doesn't break existing application. And that's why we have to create a separate version for control group. And we are trying to move people over from V1 to V2. It will take a while, yeah. Time's up.
Yeah, we're
not
going
to do it in Realm if we haven't done it.
The next talk starts at 11, so we actually have more time than that.
Okay.
This time,
this gentleman had a question.
Hello, you mentioned that you had a year and a half discussion to decide between per thread or per process model.
Yes.
Do you feel personally that they reached the best decision, or was it an unhappy compromise just to move forward?
Yes, kind of. There are some difference in opinion between upstream developer about how the CPU, the V2 CPU controllers work. And they kind of go into a deadlock situation, so they can't reach a compromise and install the whole process for about one and a half year. And finally, I proposed some changes, and finally they reach a compromise on what the current model is. It certainly is a compromise, but at least all people feel they are acceptable, and that's the way to move forward. Okay. Thanks.